our series of lectures on this question of institutional corruption. Tonight we're honored to welcome Dr. David Korn to speak. Dr. Korn is the second in the mini-series we've been conducting around the field of medicine, first with Archbishop Angel before the break. And in 3 weeks we will welcome Thomas Stossel to complete this mini-series trilogy. Dr. David Korn is one of Harvard's most distinguished scholars and what we like to call ethical activists. He was a Harvard undergraduate and studied medicine at the Harvard Medical School. In 1968, he began his career teaching and researching and then deaning and vice presidencing and inspiring at Stanford University, no doubt fearing that more than 40 years in paradise would weaken the soul. In 2008, he then left California and came back to Harvard. He's a professor of pathology and vice provost for research at the university. Now, I was especially eager to have David Korn speak in this series. Our project, our aim in this project, Institutional Corruption, is to develop academic insights that have a practical application. And Dr. Korn is the one lecturer in our series who practices this aim every single day of his job. He's been charged with developing policies that might help keep the reputation of Harvard for its integrity and independence strong. Of all of us in this series, he's the one who must bring these insights to closure in the form of policies that real people must understand and apply. We are grateful that he would add to his obligations at Harvard, the obligations of this lecture. And I would like to ask you to please join me in welcoming you to give a fifth in our series. Thank you very much.
Okay, is this on? Yeah, so right, I don't have to stand here. I'm very pleased to be here tonight. I appreciate your coming. I'm sort of the meat in the sandwich between Marsha Angel on one hand and Thomas Stossel, who you will hear in about a month on the other hand. And what I thought might be most useful is if I could provide you with a context that might help all of us understand a little better why financial conflicts of interest have become such a prominent issue in American society and certainly in academics and in academic medicine. And that's mainly the purpose that I have now in what I'm going to show you. So, whence they came, where they went, and why they vex us so. I think the first thing we need to do is agree on a definition of conflict of interest. This one is in the recent, last spring, IOM report on financial conflicts of interest in medicine. It's really an elegant definition that owes its parentage largely to Dennis Thompson. It's quite depersonalized, which I think adds to its value. And very importantly, it makes clear that a conflict of interest is a set of circumstances. It's not a character judgment. It's not a judgment about the character of an individual. It's a set of circumstances that either exist or don't exist. Now, in behavioral economic theory, and I will return to this a bit later, George Lowenstein, who is an eminent practitioner at Carnegie Mellon, provided at a seminar symposium that I will describe later, this very nice distinction between how traditional economics and behavioral economics views conflicts of interest, and you can read it as well as I. The important thing, I believe, is that we are all wired as human beings to respond to things that we're not aware of. Whether you call that subconscious, unwitting, below awareness, there are many expressions for these inputs. They are below awareness, and they definitely influence our choices, our decisions, and our actions. It's not a new concept, however, because in 1620, Francis Bacon, in Book One of Novum Organum, wrote the following: "The human understanding is no dry light, but receives infusions from the will and affections. Whence proceed sciences which may be called sciences as one would, with great praise, for what a man had rather were true, he more readily believes. This really is a kind of an expression of behavioral economics, I suppose, and it's over almost 500 years old. Where did this issue come from for academics and for academic medicine? Well, in the late 70s and 80s, there were an unfortunate series of cases of scientific misconduct that received a lot of media and congressional attention. Some of them, not all, but some of them were associated with financial conflicts of interest on the part of, as law and order might say, the perp, the perpetrator. And Congress had a number of hearings during the 80s, increasingly acerbic, and in 1991, a House committee issued a report, which was quite voluminous, entitled "Our Scientific Misconduct and Conflicts of Interest Hazardous to Your Health." And I put this up here to make a point that in the public mind, the conjunction of misconduct and conflicts of interest and adverse effects on public well-being are quite cemented to this day. Conflicts of interest are bad, they lead to bad science, and the bad science can lead to adverse consequences from the public. In 1985, Congress ordered the Public Health Service, which is the umbrella organization for the NIH and the CDC, FDA, and so forth, to write regulations on scientific misconduct. To my knowledge, this was the first time Congress had asked the government to regulate the conduct of federally funded research. The government has always been interested in how we spend their money, but the conduct of research had been left exclusively to the oversight of the academic institutions in which the faculty worked. So this directive excited quite a bit of interest in the academic and academic medical and scientific communities, and after much battling in over three years, the Public Health Service issued its regulation, and if you read the regulation, you will notice that it's pretty much confined to three things: fabrication, falsification, and plagiarism. Those are not the universe of misconduct, but they are the limit of what the academic pushback wanted the federal government to have its hand in. The idea here is, if the government's going to be involved, let's limit it as much as we can. And there were really heated meetings, conferences, and battles over that one. In 88, Congress directed the Public Health Service to regulate financial conflicts of interest. So we have the same battle lines drawn again, and this one went on for 7 years before Congress issued what is still the regulation, the Public Health Service regulation, and it also is essentially the National Science Foundation regulation on financial conflicts of interest under the title "To Ensure the Objectivity of Research." Now notice that that title doesn't identify research involving human participants. It's the objectivity of research. And again, there was an enormous amount of interaction between the government and the academic community and the scientific community to try to keep this regulation as light-handed as possible. And it is an extraordinarily light-handed regulation. It says that institutions that receive federal money must have policies in place and enforce them to detect financial conflicts of interest in individuals who are going to receive federal research funding. You must then report to the funding agency that you have identified a conflict. David Korn has a conflict, and we're not going to let him spend any of your money until we assure you that we have managed it, eliminated it, reduced it, whatever you do. You don't have to give the government any details about what the conflict is, how much it is, what kind of conflict it is, only that you have identified it and you've you've taken care of it. That's all that was required. Okay. Now, moving later into the 90s, a series of real estating reports were issued, beginning with one from the President's Commission on, well, I don't remember the exact title, but it had to do with military experiments on our U.S. civilian population during World War II that nobody knew about until much later. There were two harsh reports from the Inspector General of the Department of Health and Human Services and one from what was then the General Accounting Office. And these reports, for the first time, began to shift the focus away from individual financial conflicts of interest to institutional financial conflicts of interest. And they raised the question, how can we trust an IRB, which by definition is an institutional review body, if the institution itself has a financial investment in the research under review? I want to come back to that question. During those years in the Clinton administration, the National Bioethics Advisory Commission was formed. Harold Shapiro, then president of Princeton, was its chair. Its focus was on human subjects research, and among other things, it called for enhanced institutional management of institutional IRB and individual financial conflicts of interest. Then, turning up the heat even more, during the period 1998 to 2001, three research subjects died. Two of them were in clinical experiments on normal human physiology. They weren't drug trials, or in that they were physiological trials. And one of them, of course, was an interventional trial that involved a fellow named Jesse Gelsinger that everybody knows about. But these deaths led to an increasing frenzy of calls for enhanced federal oversight. In part, the Office for Protection from Research Risks, which was the antecedent of the OHRP, began shutting down human subjects research in major universities, Duke, University of Illinois in Chicago, University of Colorado, University of Alabama, big name institutions, and this attracted attention. Real attention. So two things happened that I was involved in. One of them was the creation of a formal accrediting organization, the AHRQ, whose purpose was to accredit human research protection programs, not just in academia, but wherever there were human research activities taking place. This was a creation of seven major not-for-profit organizations that included the AAMC, the Association of American Universities, the Land Grant Association, FASEB, the Federation of the FASEB organization is an umbrella that contains probably over 100,000 life scientists. The equivalent of FASEB, COSA, which is a consortium of social science associations, the National Health Council, which is a DC umbrella group that has in it just about every patient advocacy group that exists, as well as industry representatives, and PRIMR, which is based here in Boston, and is the organization of bioethicists, mainly. It's a professional organization heavily focused on human and animal research. The formation of AHRQ and then the formation of what became only the first of several AAMC task forces served to lower the temperature in Washington, at least. I mean, there is no doubt that these actions lowered the temperature. The idea was that the community was responding to all of this public concern. It wasn't just oblivious to it. And I believe that these actions did help us to avoid what could have been some very serious and onerous regulation or legislation. Now, the first AMC task force issued a report addressing individual financial conflicts of interest and human subjects research. Everything we did at the AAMC is directed at medical schools and teaching hospitals. And therefore, we condition these reports around human subjects research to make clear to the university presidents that we were not ordering them, giving them orders on how to do things, which would have been a major faux pas. This report, which was very influential during much of the first decade of the 21st century, established the principle of disclosure of related significant financial interests, a high standard of review, and a rebuttable presumption arguing that an individual with a significant related financial interest should not be allowed to perform research involving human subjects. The rebuttable presumption, however, could be overcome by a demonstration of compelling circumstances. And we can talk as much as you would like later on what does that mean. We did not define compelling circumstances. We did suggest that in evaluating the risks of these financial interests, there were some obvious parameters to keep in mind. And I've often summarized what I thought a compelling circumstance was in the bottom portion of this slide, that circumstances may be compelling if the research could not otherwise be conducted as safely or as effectively. And I would argue that if that were the standard of compulsion or compelling, there would probably be fewer financially conflicted individuals conducting human subjects research. But that was my take on what we meant. This same task force produced a second report, which is the first, I think, ever on recommendations for overseeing an institution's financial interests in human subjects research. Let me point out that the task force was really quite interesting. It had 28 members. It was chaired by Bill Danforth, who had been both the vice chancellor for medicine at Washington U, and then the chancellor of the university, and then he became the chairman of the board of trustees at Washington U. He was a man of utmost integrity, principle. He's just a wonderful fellow. And we had on this committee, aside from the in-group of deans and vice presidents and faculty inventors, industry ethicists, and so forth, we had seven or eight civilians who had no formal connection to either universities or academic medicine. Three or four of them were presidents of major disease advocacy groups, breast cancer, AIDS, mental illness. We had two former journalists, one of whom was running the Shorenstein program at the time here at the Kennedy School. That is, neither of these journalists were active reporters because they could not serve on such a committee. And it was very, very interesting that how little the civilians understood of the process by which scientific discovery becomes a tangible benefit of public, a tangible product of public benefit. I mean, these were people, even in the disease advocacy groups, who spent their entire lives advocating for more money for research for their disease. They had no idea how this transition occurred between scientific discovery and product. There was a lot of time spent, I'm backing up just a bit, in the very first meeting of the task force, wanting to know why faculty scientists have had anything to do with industry. It wasn't obvious to them that that was necessary. When they accepted the fact that the handoff often requires continuing involvement of the inventor, they accepted that. And then they said, well, why does money have to change? Faculty are well paid. These people are in professions because they love it. Why do I have to get more pay for participating in translating publicly funded research into public benefit? And that was a tough one. And the only answer I could imagine was that we are in a society where most people don't do anything unless they are paid to do it. That's not a satisfying answer. explanation at all. But I just want to point out that this was the composition of this task force. We define the problem, and I've transposed the definition a little bit to put it into Thompsonian structure, but it's pretty obvious to you from reading it. And we articulated a core management principle, which is clean separation of oversight and decision making between those who are involved in overseeing the research activities of the university and those who are involved in managing the university's investments. And in institutions like Harvard, for example, where there is a separate management company, that separation is pretty clean, not totally, but pretty clean. And most of the major research universities have that kind of separation of management. Now, let me go back to an earlier point I made about the federal government getting involved in managing how faculty behave when they conduct research. A cardinal feature of the post-World War II agreement between the federal government and the academic community, this is not just academic medicine, it's the whole academic community, was that the government would delegate down to the universities the responsibility of ensuring or assuring that research, federally funded research, was conducted in accordance with all applicable federal law and regulation. The assurance mechanism is in existence today. Whenever a federal grant, or anything for that matter, but certainly a federal grant, goes out to the funder from the university, let's say in the Office of Sponsored Programs, there is an individual who has to attest to every one of the assurances required by the government, which now may be somewhere between a dozen and two dozen, various things. Misconduct, disposal of radioactive materials, hazardous waste, conflict of interest, scientific misconduct, this, that, and the other thing. And they are attesting that we have policies, and we enforce policies, and if we have to notify you of certain things, we shall notify you. This is a mechanism that I don't believe exists in any sector of the United States economy, a mechanism with the government overseers. And it is based on, and I will argue, on a relationship of trust. The government does not delegate this kind of responsibility to ensure that federal rules are being followed unless it has a reason to believe that it can trust the institutions to which it is delegating this responsibility. And the reason why institutional conflict of interest is so troubling, so vexing, is that the existence of institutional financial interests in research being conducted by the faculty shapes the assumption of trustworthiness of the institution. That's how I have seen it, that's how I believe it. I don't know whether you all will accept that, but I see that as one of the fundamental problems that we face as academicians. Now, what's happened since the early 2000s? Well, as you all know, financial conflict of interest is a hot topic in American society. People who have been wiped out by fraudulent accounting, by Wall Street, maneuverings and so forth, so that the public and the media and Congress are very, very sensitive to financial conflicts of interest. There have been a number of books. Marcia Angel, one of my speakers, the author of one. Jerry Casera, who is another editor of the New England Journal, and has a teaching relationship with Harvard Medical School, but another on the Tate. Jennifer Washburn is a law professor at the University of Washington in Seattle, who didn't limit her gunfire to academic medicine or the medical profession, but brought in the world of higher education. And of course, one of the early books calling attention to these dangers was by former Harvard University president Barry Bach, and it's been a superb book. And I certainly would recommend it to you if you're interested. Eliot Spitzer, who was the Attorney General of New York and was a speaker in this series, deserves a great deal of credit for bringing financial conflicts of interest, not only in medicine, but in other sectors, into the public consciousness. He actually began this avalanche when he filed criminal complaints against GlaxoSmithKline for suppressing negative results of clinical trials of antidepressants in children and adolescents. They selectively published the positive, or arguably positive, trials and buried most of the negatives. And he charged them with criminal fraud, them and a few smaller pharmaceutical co-conspirators. And he got a major settlement financially and also got them to agree, this is Glaxo, that it would post on its website all of the clinical trials that it was funding so that scholars who were wondering what happened in that trial or why haven't I seen a publication on this trial could go back to the website and assure themselves that indeed Glaxo had funded a trial and buried it. Spitzer then went after diverse sectors of the financial services industry, like in Grim Reaper. The last settlement was only 2 years ago, Fidelity Funds. When Spitzer moved on, Andrew Cuomo, who's still the New York Attorney General, turned his sights on university financial aid officials for cozy relationships with preferred lenders for student loans, which were quite prevalent at the time that Cuomo began looking at them. The lending company provided kickbacks to the university of the student payments, and one eminent university president rationalized this by saying that they put the money into student aid, so it was kind of circulating. But nonetheless, Cuomo didn't see it that way, so there was a settlement there. There was a similar settlement on overseas studies programs, again, self-dealing. And now, Cuomo, in the U.S. attorney for the Southern District after the financial meltdown. In terms of the currency of this issue in the public, I put two examples. This is from a suit filed by the state of Ohio against the bond traders, the trading firms. And you can read that, but they are arguing that the rating agencies essentially sold their integrity to the highest bidder. And I hadn't realized that their rating agencies are paid by the issuers of securities and don't get their full pay unless they deliver the rating that the issuers demand. So that's a cozy question. And then this is an interesting one from about two years ago in the Washington Post. There was a federal appellate decision in the D.C. Circuit involving whether financial planners could call themselves advisors. Investment advisor. And the appellate court said, no, a stockbroker is a salesman, not an advisor. So this has nothing to do with medicine, but it clearly is in the public consciousness. In 04 and 05, NIH got into very serious trouble when it turned out that some of their senior scientists were engaged in transactions with industry that were forbidden by federal ethics regulations and had never even been reported to NIH. This led to a very draconian regulation that essentially barred all interactions of NIH scientists with industry. And at that time, several influential congresspersons asked, well, if this is good for the NIH, why isn't it good for the awardees who receive NIH research funds? If it's good for the NIH, why isn't it good for the awardee community? That question is still active in the Congress. And these regulations are, in effect, slightly mitigated at NIH. In 06, NIH did what it called 18 targeted site visits of university grant recipients and identified these three areas of concern. The bold one is especially troubling because I've told you that the conflict of interest regulation is as lighthearted, light-handed as anything you could imagine. And the major requirement is that the institution just report to the funding agency. And they found that a number of these institutions had forgotten to file reports. So, well, we all forget. without any public comment. But the attorney, the inspector general looks at that website, and the inspector general decided there was something right for that office. And they then investigated NIH's oversight under the regulation and issued a very severely critical report, partly calling on NIH to get its act together, but also requiring, that is, recommending in its report that institutions disclose all potential conflicts to the NIH, and that NIH should get involved in examining the review and mitigation processes and decisions made by the universities, which would mean a tremendously more intrusive NIH presence in what is now exclusively an institutional requirement. Enter Senator Grassley, who wanted to get this one. There was also a very interesting, publicly, widely reported instance of the National Cancer Institute, a very large multi-institutional National Cancer Institute trial, testing computed tomography chest scans, CT scans, as a preventive for early stage lung cancer. And it turned out that the principal investigator and several of her team had something like 12 patents pending on technological improvements that would have been worth a fortune if the government decided to recommend that everybody gets routine CT chest scans regularly to detect lung cancer. Their argument when confronted was they forgot about these patents. So, you know, the institutions forgot, the investigators forgot. NIH now starts following up with the inspector general living on the NIH campus. Christie, who's now the governor of New Jersey, was an U.S. attorney, subpoenaed records of payments from the 5 or 6 major orthopedic device vendors to orthopedic surgeons, accusing them of kickbacks and violation of stock law and various other things. This was again a multi-$100 million settlement, and each defendant company had to agree that they would henceforth post all payments to physicians on their websites. So this was the first time that the law required vendors to the healthcare industry to actually post the payments they were making to, in this case, the orthopedists. Christie and again Senator Grassley then asked the question, well, if we now know that the companies are paying these monies to the orthopedists who are faculty largely, are the faculty reporting these payments to their institutions? So they started looking into this, and they broadened their inquiry by going after psychiatrists, orthopedists, and cardiologists, alleging the failures of, I think Marcia Angel introduced us to this term, key opinion leader physicians, because the companies are interested in non-key opinion leaders. And as you know, Harvard is now caught up in one of these inquiries, asking for quite a while. I would just point out, as a bit of information, that the industry has increasingly adopted reporting of payments to vendors or other actors in the healthcare community publicly on their website, sometimes voluntarily, other times as part of the settlement of criminal complaints. These are three big ones from the very recent past, the Cephalon, Lilly, and Pfizer. And those are, to most people, those are large sums of money. Perhaps for the industry, they're accounting errors, I don't know. And these also have corporate integrity agreements that are binding them to certain ways of conduct under penalty of having the case reopened. This was an editorial page headline, a cartoon in the Washington Post about 3 years ago, highly complimentary to the medical profession. This is, again, some recent updates when Lilly posted its payments for the first quarter of 2009. One of the most highly paid was a psychiatrist who actually has a loose faculty relationship with Stanford. I'm so you say. This is a direct quote from him. He was concerned about how his patients would see this, but then once he told them, they responded positively, so he had no more concerns about the posting. Here's one from a few weeks ago from Parker's own Brigham and Women's Hospital that you can read. I think the really important message here is this quote from the U.S. Director of Media Relations for Black Cell, that she's not sure whether the physician faculty member will be as much in your need as a speaker without these titles. So for those who believe they're in demand because they're great human beings, they would keep this account. In 2005, we had a closed workshop with the Association of American Universities returning to these financial conferences and our interest in medicine. We identified two big problems, a lack of consistency in how the institutions were behaving, and a conflict of what I call a conflict of public expectations that I hope to return to before this ends. The public, on the one hand, more and more, especially with a $32 billion NIH research budget, wants to see results. They want tangible benefits. At the same time, they want the researchers in their institutions to be as pure as the driven snow, as the saying goes. And this is an incredible conflict for institutions and faculty to manage. By interacting with industry and trying to commercialize their discoveries, they are in fact following the expectations of the public payers for that research. And increasingly, the focus of NIH itself on demonstrating payoff from the investment. And yet at the same time, they have to remain clean, and that's tough, and I'll leave that for now. We then formed yet another committee. It's really a small task force, which issued yet another report that I was very much involved in. And I will simply say that this report is a how-to-do-it manual. Any institution that wants to write conflict of interest reports can actually get templates out of this report and fill in the name of the institution, and voila, you can have a conflict of interest policy. So it really is a how-to-do-it manual. And it was partly a sense of frustration that both organizations had with the laggardness of the member-run institutions in coming up to speed on credible policies. We did yet another study of industry funding and medical education that, for purposes of time, I'm not going to go into. I will show you how these practices that Marcia Angel did talk about are viewed by some cartoonists. I think this one's kind of clever. You all read it? Yeah. These are the concerns about industry funding for medical education that are pretty obvious when you think about them. But the one I want to point out is the last one, and that is the growing body of scientific evidence about reciprocity and influence in the inadequacy of disclosure as a safeguard. So since we were involved in these two large policy efforts, one again on financial conflicts of interest in research, the other on industry support and medical education, some of my colleagues and colleagues at the Vail College of Medicine put on a real scientific symposium. I was starving for some real science at that point after those years in D.C. And this was a real symposium with really good presenters. We were very, very fortunate to get some of the leading figures in the field, including one of Harvard's own, Max Basenick, who unfortunately is, I think, in Europe this week. This is just my very brief snapshot summary of the presentations. If anybody wants the monograph that describes their presentation, just tell me, because it's freely available. And we've actually disseminated almost 15,000 of them. The first point is that using functional MRI, scientists are identifying actual neural pathways that get lit up when people are making choices or decisions, and those pathways are very influenced by acts of kindness, or gratuities, or favors. And some of the experiments are really quite elegant. I'm not an expert in this field, but they seem elegant to me. And so the concept is growing in the field that there's a lot of cognitive behaviors that occur beneath consciousness, beneath the level of awareness. One of the speakers coined the phrase deliberation without intention. Dan Ariely is well known to all of you, very clever psychologist or behavioral economist, hard to tell them apart these days. He gave us several messages. One of them is that we all can tolerate a limited amount of dishonest behavior without impairing our self-image of rectitude. So that the set point for us on what's right and wrong isn't an absolute, but it's a zone. But it's a limited zone because people who can cheat will not cheat to the maximum extent if given the opportunity. But that little bit is okay. Beyond that, I don't do that, right? So we all seem to have this. And interestingly, Ariely, one experiment seemed quite suggestive that mindfulness will significantly reduce the amount of cheating that we will do given an opportunity. George Lowenstein, I already referred to his conception of conflict of interest from a behavioral economics point of view. He also pointed out, very similarly to what Dan Ariely had said, that everybody has a bit of moral wiggle room. He also had, at least at that time, one very impressive experiment that I had seen about the value of disclosure and the fact that it may give the advisor moral license for strategic exaggeration to the advisor's self-interest. It might actually enhance the authority of the disclosure. This is another cartoon about disclosure. For full disclosure, but your NASCAR outfit makes me queasy, guy. Then Max talked about, again, very similar, bounded awareness, bounded ethicality. Very nice quote from Upton Sinclair. It's difficult to get a man to understand something when his salary depends on his not understanding it. He also drew a rather chilling parallel between the rise and fall of the accounting profession, which I understand Max is quite a natural authority on, and medicine. And one that he argued that he thinks the medical profession may be on the same cusp of perceived failure of fiduciary responsibility to the public. Okay, where have these things gone? Well, this now comes to the concluding movement of this presentation. NIH, under orders of the Inspector General and with substantial congressional prodding, issued its intention to develop a new conflict of interest rule. Again, current one is the 95 gentle rule. They are now under orders to generate a new rule. And in fact, a congressional budget bill gave them a May 1 deadline, May 1, 2010, to have a new rule in place. In their advance notice, NIH asked respondents to address a number of questions. And I have taken some liberty in the questions they asked to pose questions that I think are fundamental root questions to how we go forward in this area. Should management of conflicts be risk-based or formulaic? Formulaic are red lines. You have this? No. You have that? No. Or is it a risk assessment? Or a mixture of both. Are the arguments in favor of formulaic more than logistical, and if so, are they any different from the kind that we were raising in the late 90s about why we could not put more investment into IRBs? We just couldn't afford the resources until we were forced. Secondly, there are a whole lot of risks that we are talking about when we are worried about financial conflicts of interest. You may have even more than these, but we've got human research subjects versus research versus the integrity, risks to scientific integrity versus risks to students and trainees versus reputational risks to individuals and to institutions versus risks to the public. I mean, a perfect clinical trial, I caused perhaps tens of thousands of adverse events or even deaths. So the public is also at risk when the science is not objective and demonstrative of integrity. And is there a rank order of importance here? If so, what are the relative weights? And will everybody agree with these relative weights? I don't know the answer to any of these questions, by the way. There is emerging science on influence and reciprocity. How can this not be incorporated into new regulations in 2010? But if so, how? How should it be incorporated? Should we, for example, require zero threshold reporting of any financial interest that could possibly be related to one's academic responsibilities? Or should we say, no, we don't want anything below $10,000, which is what the current regulations say? That's a number pulled entirely out of the air. It has no face validity around it. But it was the compromise with the academic community in writing that 95 back. What do we do about our new deepening understanding of disclosure? And one of several of your faculty in the Kennedy School have a new book out. I think Mary Graham is one of the authors on the promise and perils of transparency or disclosure. How can we position ourselves to meet these conflicting expectations, which fundamentally are questioning the rationale for federal funding of research? The rationale is dangerously shifting from an investment in knowledge that will produce benefits 5, 10, 20, 30 years from now, into near-term expectations of benefits, more and more, and especially at the NIH. How do we position ourselves to meet that expectation versus the integrity of our institution and ourselves? Can policies protect the university as an independent arbiter of knowledge in coexistence with the university as an engine of economic development and help us sustain public trust in what we do? Can the assurance compact survive? And where are we now? Well, the OIG, bless it, came out with another report in November. They looked at how institutions manage federal conflicts of interest on NIH-funded research and found these things. 90% of the institutions rely solely on researchers' discretion to decide what should be reported and what should not be reported. Greater than half do not require specific values. I don't know what the Kennedy School does, but you know, some places say less than 10,000, between 10 and 100 or whatever. No routine verification. How are we going to verify what our faculty members tell us where their learnings or relationships? Do we demand their tax returns? I don't know any university official who would dare to do that. But the IG was almost sneeringly skeptical of the fact that we have no way of verifying what the faculty tell us. Lack of management documentation, and what is that is the institutions are not required to report their own interests under the current grant. It only deals with individuals. These are the recommendations that now NIH is facing as it writes a new rule. This is current. The IG wants a detailed report of financial conflicts, and it's not just David Korn has a financial conflict, but we take care of the Pellwater conflicts. That's not going to suffice. They want the institutions to collect information on all significant financial interests held by researchers, not just what I choose to identify. They want methods to verify ensure documentation, okay, ensure enforcement. You should say yes, of course, but maybe it's not so obvious in some places. And then they want NIH to increase its oversight and issue a regulation, and that is the process that they said that is now underway. The rule, the draft rule, proposed rule is written, and it's under review by the department, and it's going to be out quite soon for comment. And I stop here with some words that I have found exceedingly powerful. They arise in an AAUP Declaration of Principles from 1915, almost 100 years ago. This has nothing to do with financial conflicts of interest. It was all about tenure. I mean, the issue of why do faculty need tenure. And the key point is that universities serve the public in need of expert guidance and greater knowledge. And these clients have a stake in disinterested professional opinion stated without a fear or a favor, which the institution is morally required to respect. I think that's exactly the issue we're facing right now. And it's at the very heart of the issue of how do we reconcile the pressure to show us results, tangible results, and the pressure or our own pressure to remain institutions and faculty members of integrity. Thank you very much.
Laboratory on federal money, and he could not become a factory. So he set up a
startup company to try to make this a economically viable technology. And the company succeeded in getting a class-specific antibody. That is, it wasn't just for you, but it was for all of us with certain diseases. And they came to him to run the first into-human experiment. He came to the dean's office. He was terribly troubled by the ethical conundrum that he was in, knowing that these were going to be his patients whom he knew better than anybody, and to trust in him, that he knew the technology better than anybody at that point. And therefore, he could probably do this first into human study better and more safely than anybody else. But he had a huge financial commitment, and he knew it. And so we pondered it without any outside guidance at that time, long before the red was published. And we decided to set up an ad hoc monitoring group of uninvested experts to monitor the entire process, the consent, the protocol, the analysis, and so forth. Well, that was a one-off situation, and it was fairly easy to find uninvested experts. Today, it might be impossible because of the prevalence of industry relations with talented faculty. I mean, they do go after the KOLs. Why should they bother with anyone who isn't? Right? They want to be. And when you have a faculty like Stanford did, and Harvard does, and Yale, and University of Washington, St. Louis, and others, most of your successful faculty scientists are in relationships with industry. Not all, but most. So I'm kind of against absolute prohibitions, although I can imagine some particularly egregious situations where the answer would always be no, because I think you need a little bit of room for wise judgment on a case that might not give a needed benefit if you really said no, you can't do it. And I don't know. I don't think those are that common, but they're certainly greater than zero. I'm sorry for the length of that, but it's a difficult issue.
Yes. I'm Norman Daniels, Harvard School of Public Health. I had a question which comes out of the expression that the cow is out of the barn. It basically looks
horse.
Horse is out of the barn. Shows how much time I spend in barns.
Cows are raised in the hobby yard.
Yeah, right. So we had the Bayh-Dole Act and enormous encouragement of people to invest in these entrepreneurial relationships with business. Now we can't find people who are unconnected to that.
Generally not very productive.
Pardon?
You can, but they tend not to be highly
right.
productive.
So the question is, would there have been a different way to encourage the translation of knowledge into public benefit without having tainted the whole of the human reservoir of knowledgeable scientists?
That's a great question. I have a conflict. My wife was actually partly involved in writing the Bayh-Dole legislation and keeps pointing out to me that nowhere in the legislation do you find the word money. Nowhere does it say that anybody should be enriched by the act of technology transfer. That certainly isn't required by the law. We're back into the situation again of institutions and inventors realizing that they can sometimes become quite wealthy off their work. And we live in a capitalistic society that rewards wealth. And so I don't know how to answer that anymore. I mean, I think it's a terrific question, but maybe it would only work the way you might desire it to work if we were wired differently than we are now.
Well, I'm not sure it's an issue of basic wiring. I'm very skeptical of these attempts to pin this on some untold story from human evolution. It seems to me that we are created by the institutions we live in as well, that they shape our motivations and intentions. And if we pass laws that encourage a certain kind of entrepreneurial relationship of basic knowledge generators and translators of knowledge into technology, then maybe we end up tainting a pool of people who, and we have no way to turn that around after the fact, or no obvious way. But maybe there would have been a better approach, and I don't blame it on human nature. I think we're as much the result of institutional shaping of how we behave. For example, was the translation of science into knowledge much worse prior to Bayh-Dole? Did we get fewer inventions? I'm not sure how we would measure that, because many other things have changed.
There may be economists sitting in this room who have done studies of that, and I know a number that are not here above it. And certainly, if you look at the number of patents that's exploded post Bayh-Dole, the number of licenses has exploded, the number of startup companies has exploded. Now, it's post hoc, it may not be proto hoc, I don't know, but the fact is that if you look before 1980 and after, there's a dramatic increase that continues in the intellectual propertyization of scientific discoveries. So I don't know, those are the data that are out there. And there was certainly plenty of entrepreneurial activity going on before Bayh-Dole. I mean, Route 128 here in Massachusetts, the Bay Area in California, that was all pre-Bayh-Dole. So certainly there was invention and development of invention. So I'm actually sitting on a National Academy of Sciences committee that is supposedly evaluating how universities have managed their responsibilities under Bayh-Dole. And that's how I know that there are some studies by economists of these variables, and that's what they find. But would it have happened without Bayh-Dole? I don't know how to answer that. Yes, sir.
First, one or two brief observations and then a question. To the point that Norman just raised about was there as much research, translational research, before Bayh-Dole as after? You can't judge by the number of patents, because the number of the policies of the patent office change dramatically, and things have been patented in the last 30 years that never would have been patented before. And the fact that there is more commercial activity, which reflects, which is connected with increased patents, doesn't mean that there is more creativity now. I admit that we don't have any hard evidence, but I have a clear memory of what academic medicine and clinical research was like in the 50s and 60s and 70s, because I was in the middle of it. I was editor of the Journal of Clinical Investigation. I was a clinical investigator myself. I was president of the American Society for Clinical Investigation. And I'm fully familiar with what the atmosphere was. It was electric. There was all sorts of research going on without the stimulus of getting rich. Now, I admit it's not quantitative, and it would be nice to have a study, but it's my strong impression that you don't need to have the dangling of money in order to get clinical scientists to be interested in doing things that will diagnose and cure disease. That's my observation. My question to you is this. Wouldn't it be useful to begin to dissect this problem by making a clear distinction between medical education and the conflicts of interest, which are innumerable in the area of education and marketing on the one hand, and basic research on the other? It seems to me that a powerful argument could be made that there is simply no justification, none whatsoever, for allowing academic people to make money from participating in the marketing and so-called educational programs of industry. Yet that's where an enormous amount of money is spent and where an enormous amount of conflicts of interest are found. The other part of the problem, namely conflicts of interest with basic research, my question to you would be, couldn't we deal with that by saying, of course, we want to facilitate that with grants and contracts, but they should be arranged in such a way that there is no personal enrichment. Maybe institutions should get a fair share of the royalties, but couldn't we have an arrangement which said, if, as you put it in part of your lecture, you're a member of this faculty, you're well paid, you have a great job, you have a great opportunity to do what you want, you shouldn't expect to get additional riches by doing applied research or doing translational research.
Right.
What's wrong with that attitude? Why couldn't that be enforced?
I, for interest of time, I took out several slides. I'm an old pathologist, so I learned to always carry slides around with me, and that's never part of the habit. But I don't disagree with that. The NMC report that I did not talk about called for abolishing all the things that you and I would like to see abolished. And they are superfluous, in my view. I mean, I think my own personal view is that, and I know we've had some arguments about that too, I think it's important for academic scientists to be able to interact with the cognate industries that can make their work useful to the public.
So do I.
I think those relationships can be managed through institutional policies that are enforced that keep the research agreements clean, so there's nothing on top for anybody. It's cost recovery, essentially. That make sure, as department's policies do say, that the PI controls the study. I heard Elliot Hampton at the Harvard Medical School a year ago talking at a summer lifespan celebration at the medical school about how his group, which is group Gene Brennan created, do large-scale clinical trials for industry. And he made it clear that they signed a contract in which their investigators, Harvard investigators, own that study, lock, stock, and barrel. And they will publish that study, and the industry has no control over it, whatever. That's what you and I are both talking about, I think. And I think that's the way things can be done and should be done. And I agree with you that all of the entitlement garbage that goes along with speakers' bureaus and all that kind of nonsense should be forever. So I agree with you there. We might argue over whether, this is very unfair, but whether indeed medical journals ought to accept pharmaceutical company ads.
We argue about that. I agree with you, they shouldn't.
Yeah. I wonder if you could say something. Hi. I wonder if you could say some things about where the interest of the university is. So let me amplify. The kind of behavior, the entanglement with the industry, the amassing of riches, which earlier would have been considered to be beyond the wildest dreams of an academic, is this something that's good for the university, or is this a problem for the university? That's one question. Now, if it's a problem for the university, because there's a threat to academic integrity and public credibility and so on, how much leverage does the university have just as one institution? You know, you showed the slide, the quotation that maybe this doctor who's on the faculty here won't get such good fees if he leaves the faculty. So there's that. And besides which, it's you know, it's pleasant to be around colleagues and to have a prestigious appointment. So there's some leverage there. But there's always the risk that, well, if we tighten the screws too tight, they'll just go to another place. And that would be bad for us. And every place has to think about that. But it might be possible to act in concert. Now, suppose that all major medical research centers pressed very hard for a national law forbidding this kind of profit seeking. So that would just that would eliminate the chance that any one of them would lose faculty to the other. Would there be a risk that they would lose faculty just to academia, so that there would be an outflow of these people who would set themselves up in other kinds of research institutes that weren't academic, so that it would still be bad for the university. So what where are interests and what power do we have?
Well, I can't conceive the role of the universities, to say nothing of medical schools and teaching hospitals, agreeing on that sort of legislation. But I will tell you that in my career, I have often heard that if we do X, Y, Z, we're going to lose all these great faculty. Stanford, when I was there, and I've been gone now for 15 years, so I can't speak now, although I'm pretty sure they're still doing it, but I can't put a test on it. But while I was there, we had very strong conflict of interest policies. We didn't lose any faculty because of them. In 1989 or 90, when Dan Tostison, I think it was, around that time, when Dan Tostison was the dean of Harvard Medical School, and Harvard Medical School issued its very first financial conflict of interest policy for the medical faculty. It was regarded as one of the toughest in the country, maybe the toughest, and there were threats that, oh, well, we'll leave, they'll leave, we can't recruit anybody. Nonsense. That didn't happen. But the fact of the matter is that I don't think that tough conflict of interest policies need inhibit legitimate interactions around discovery and translation and research. And I don't think they discourage entrepreneurial spirit, although you're going to hear a very different story from Professor Stossel next month. In my experience, it's nonsense. I will tell you again an anecdote. Early in my deanship, a group of senior clinical faculty who were all investigators came to me. They came to me and they said, we believe that our informed consent documents should list any financial interest that we or the university might have in any clinical research for which we are recruiting new participants. And we wrote that into the medical school policy and convinced the university about a year later to put it into the university policy. This was faculty initiated. It wasn't administrators and bureaucrats. It was faculty who felt there was something wrong with not telling people up front that I, your doctor, has an invention or something and I may get some money out of it. We were told that we'd never do another clinical trial. Nobody would have done anything. Catastrophic. Not true. So I have no evidence that doing what I would think of as the right thing, and I really don't mean to sound like some Victorian monk, but doing the right thing, I have never seen it hit an academic program. I have never seen it drive away creative faculty. I just haven't seen it. I've heard the thrust a lot, but then you call the bluff, and side did a pretty good thing about it.
I have a question, first of all, just as a purely as a philosopher, thinking about conceptual distinctions. You were very proud of the definition of conflict of interest that you presented to us, and I'm very worried about it, because you asked us at the end to consider the how much weight we should put on medical research, the public, students, in evaluating the risks to various elements, right, scientific integrity. These are obviously interests, and you asked us to rank them. They obviously, if we put scientific integrity first, but we say we also do have some concern about risks to the public, you'll have a primary interest of scientific research. You have a conflict between that and a secondary interest in protecting the public. On your definition, you're involved in a conflict of interest. Now, obviously, whenever we have various sorts of interests, they may all be relevant, and they should all, you know, perhaps have some place and be ranked, as you pointed out. This is not a way to define, I think, the problematic conflicts of interest, where you have irrelevant considerations. I mean, I didn't see the word irrelevant in that.
Secondary
is not mean irrelevant. If I have a primary interest in scientific integrity and a secondary interest in the teaching of students, I should allow my primary interest to be affected by my secondary. That's secondary to some degree. That's not going to capture the idea of a problematic conflict of interest. So I just think, I mean, it's a, you know, from the point of view of the world, maybe a minor point, but it would be good to get, I think, somewhat better definition. The question that I have substantively is the emphasis, and I might be wrong, but that's the way I see it. Okay. The emphasis on controlling. At one point you said that by action of your committee, ARP, it was called?
No, that's the accrediting entity.
Okay, but by action of that entity, I quoted, you said, we helped avoid some seriously onerous legislation. Okay. Now, the question is, you made it seem at that point that that was a good thing. And now we're facing onerous legislation from Congress. And what I want to ask you is whether you think, or by way of the NIH, whether that's a good thing, or whether the Academy is so intense about its being separated from government regulation that it might not be better to simply think about regulating the pharmaceutical companies. So, of course, the question may be, who is it easier to regulate, okay, who's got more lobbyists, okay? But ideally, if you could just tell the pharmaceutical companies, you can't offer them this, okay, then it's not a question of regulating the behavior of the investigator, because the investigator has no opportunity to have, you know, get anything from the company, all right? When Spitzer goes after the company, okay, he's dealing with the root of the problem, okay? So if academics are really so resistant to further regulation from Washington, is there any hope of trying to regulate the pharmaceutical companies and eliminate the temptations they offer?
Well, two things. First of all, as I conceive it, one can have many primary interests. So it isn't just one. And I agree with you that we are awash in conflicts of interest in our professions and our disciplines as academics. I'll also tell you that, I mean, again, you know, this is anecdotal. In my tenure as dean, we had maybe a dozen and a half cases of professional misbehaviors, including scientific misconduct, and not one of them was driven by money. They were driven by getting ahead, getting a grant, getting a paper published before my competitor did. I'm a fellow and I need this publication because I'm applying for jobs and just finish off the experiments, you know, from my own mind. But not one of them was driven by overt evidence of financial enrichment. So I will agree with Tom Stossel, as a matter of fact, that we are awash in conflicts of interest all the time. We have to make choices, we have to make judgments, and I think the issue of money may be one of the less compelling ones for people who want to succeed at it. That's just my experience. The issue of regulation is this. You don't want the federal government regulating the details of your behavior as a scholar. You just don't. They don't have any particular skill, insight, knowledge, or capability of doing the job better than we can if we put our minds to doing so. I mean, we have institutional and school policies, and I would suspect that most people here try very hard to adhere to them. Yeah, I don't know that, but I would assume that. And so, by developing policies from within and enforcing them, there is a sensitivity to what life in academia is all about that I think helps to make policies that are both effective and sustainable without choking off valuable academic work. And I don't know that the government has any, in fact, I would say the government has no particular ability to do this. And in fact, NIH has been very resistant and has been excoriated for it in Congress, for has been very resistant to the Inspector General's continued push that they should be more involved in how these things are being done. What they want is they want the institutions to do it and to take it seriously and follow their obligations and not forget for 7 or 8 months that they have to file these reports with the NIH. That's what they want. They don't want to be out there because they're not a regulatory agency.
There's a question.
Mark Roberts from the School of Public Health. First, a quick comment.
Who's speaking?
Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm hidden in the shadows, right. The first, on this point about being awash in conflicts of interest, I think it's important to put the scientific conflicts of interest in the context of the pervasive conflicts of interest that are generated by fee-for-service reimbursement inside the medical system. And in some ways, I think, dwarf the scientific conflicts of interest in terms of potential impact on patient well-being, potential waste of resources, and so on. So that's just a kind of contextual comment. But I want to go to the philosophy of what you've raised, and to raise two questions. The first is, what is the standard we should use for judging alternative regulatory regimes? It seems to me you've, by and large, used a pretty straightforward objective utilitarian standard. That is, we should judge alternative regimes by their effect on the long-run well-being of the population as measured by health status and certain other criteria. And there are questions about what discount rate we use and how much we value the future versus the present and a whole bunch of other things. But that's the basic frame that I hear you using. And I want to raise the question about whether or not that's entirely the right frame to use. Because it seems to me that one of the things that's been happening to the university has been that as we've imported these commercial incentives, we have changed the definition implicit in what it means to be a good person in the university. So I want to raise a kind of virtue theory or Aristotelian consideration here, that what's going on is, going back to Bud Relman's comment, it used to be that we had a notion of what it meant to be an appropriate scientist or an appropriate doctor. And Norman suggested that institutions shape people. I think we don't need to redo nature-nurture controversy now, but it's also the case that there are big sorting processes that occur. People join institutions in part because their values and the values of the institution line up. That's why my students at the School of Public Health are always so uncomfortable when they go to the Harvard Business School, because the average values in the business school and the School of Public Health are so clearly different. And I'm afraid that what's happening is we are recruiting a different set of people into the university, and we're winding up with a different distribution of characters in that sense. And that might be a bad thing apart from its utilitarian consequences. And I wonder how you feel about that.
Well, if you'll permit me, I want to answer your question, but I just want to remind the audience that my last philosophy course was my freshman year at college here with Raphael Demos, and I have
that was my first one also. Raphael Demos.
But seriously speaking, I do think that in science, most of the work, most of the scholarship is not supported by universities. It's supported by sponsors, external sponsors, whether they're industrial or foundations or the federal government. I believe that it's inevitable if you set your career to becoming as good a scientist as you can and reaping academic awards, promotions, whatever, that you do become, and I'm now giving you my personal view, maybe you're wrong, you do become very attuned to the expectations of your funders. I mean, if your lab is running on an extra of ABC funding, you have students, you have fellows, you have technicians, you have colleagues, all of them dependent on a sustained flow of revenue to support your area of scholarship. And yes, I imagine you get quite sensitive to the directives or the suggestions of your funders. Secondly, I've spent my life in academic medicine. I was an NIH-supported researcher for a long, long time, and so on and so forth. I think it's unfortunate, but it is understandable, that we seem to have lost, at least in the health sciences funding agencies, mainly the NIH, right? The clear pursuit of fundamental knowledge. And I think it's inevitable because when you have a $32 billion budget, those who are paying for the research, the taxpayers, are not really interested in the latest genetic pathway or the latest epigenetic this or that. They want results. I mean, they want their sick loved ones to find remedies, preventatives, better diagnostics. And so what I have seen, as I guess I got my first NIH grant in 1967 or something, what I have seen is a distinct push in the NIH for more and more translational research. And I think that push is in response to congressional pressure, and it's in response to patient disease advocacy pressure and all kinds of things. It worries me. It worries me that if we all become translational, we will use up the store of fundamental knowledge that's been created over the last several decades, and we'll become sterile in 10 or 20 or 30 years. There'll be no paradigm-shifting breakthrough discoveries. That is the role of government funding. It used to be, and now it's beginning to shift more to show us the benefit. And that, I think, definitely affects those whose livelihoods and programs are dependent on winning money from those sponsors. So are the new faculty recruits in medicine, biomedicine, different from what they were before? Probably they are. And probably they're more conscious of an expectation that their work might lead to some useful public benefit. I worked on little viruses that infect bacteria that had no commercial interest of any kind. But I did it because it was a wonderful hot area of molecular biology and I became fascinated with it. I never thought anything I did would have any commercial power, ever. But I think now, when you're recruiting new generations of faculty, they're probably much more aware of it than they were 40 or 50 years ago. Now, whether that's good or bad, I don't know. I think it is creating problems for us. And I don't disagree with your issue about fee-for-service medicine. Was it you?
Yes.
But that's another issue for another day, and we're not going to get into that today. But yes, I think there's been a change, and I think it's that change that creates such a challenge for all of us as parts of a top-ranking university to find ways of protecting the integrity of the institution, ourselves, our students, the work we do, the advice we give to the society, to consulting, to congressional testimony, whatever we do. You know, people say, well, I have consulting privileges. Sure, but you're always a Harvard professor when you consult. You're always a Harvard professor when the New York Times reporter wants to know what you think about global warming or wind power or whatever it might be. You can't ever not be a Harvard professor, whether you want to be or not. And I think we've got to educate our faculty better than we do, that that, in fact, is one of the burdens that comes with accepting an appointment at a first-rate university or appointment at a first-rate teaching hospital. And I don't know that we've been very successful or diligent about addressing that issue. So that's not a complete answer, but I don't know what else I can say about it.
Sorry, I apologize. We have gone over. This has been extraordinary. Thank you.